Hi all. In the first two lectures, we saw about conductors, what is meant by current, current density, and different terms. Now let us get into polarization. We solved some problems also in the last lecture, and you did well during your or in the review questions. So let us get into polarization in a dielectric material. So till now it was about conductors, and what is the peculiarity of conductors? Conductors are having free electrons, right? That is why we have a high value of conductivity. Sigma is very 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 much greater than 1 in case of conductors, and whenever you apply an electric field, as shown here in this side, when you apply an electric field here, it is given positive, and this side you have negative plate. So what it means is that you have an electric field in this direction, so that electrons are moving in the opposite direction. So or your electrons are getting drifted from one atom to another, so that causes current. But in an insulator, these electrons are not that readily available to move. They are stuck with the nucleus, or they cannot move freely. So that is the peculiarity of insulators. So what will happen when an insulator or an insulator we are applying an electric field? That is what we are going to discuss in polarization. So before understanding polarization, we should just pick up, or our consideration is about an atom. It's like this, that an atom is having a nucleus consisting of proton and neutrons, where proton is having are charged particles, positively charged particles, and electrons are negatively charged particles. And and when you consider the total atom, atom stays neutral because you have equal number of positive and negative charges. Because of that, so in a general case, we can consider that these charges are plus Q and minus Q respectively. Understood? For our consideration, we are taking it as plus Q charges as the positive charge and minus Q charges the negative charge of the total negative charge of the electrons. Okay, so under a normal condition, as shown here, let me say this red part, this is the positive nucleus, or that is the plus Q charge, and surrounding it your minus Q is distributed. Surrounding that, your minus Q is distributed as an electron cloud. That is the normal condition. So it will have a spherical shape and all. You can consider an atom to be spherical and nucleus at the center, and it is having electron cloud around it in the spherical shape. So under, when we are not applying electric field, in that condition, these charge centers, means positive and negative charge centers, will coincide. Understood? So means wherever your positive charge center is there, there only your negative charge center also will be, because it is all electrons are homogeneously distributed in the atom. Because of that, we can say that it is equivalent to considering it at the center, right? This we already considered. We have considered about a spherical sphere where your charge is distributed. Then we found out the electric field also. Afterwards, we concluded that it is equivalent to placing the charge at the same charge at the center. Similarly, even though your negative charge is distributed all around the atom, you can consider it to be at the center. So in this case, we can say charge centers coincide when there is no field applied. Okay, anyhow, this electrons and protons, whatever it is, these are charges, right? Having some mass, and these are charges. So what will happen when we apply an electric field? When we apply an electric field, let me say this is the direction in which I am applying electric field. Once our electric field is applied, what will happen? Electric field means what? That is the force, right? Force applied per unit charge. Because of this force, the charge, or this electric field, is exerting a force on every charge in this atom, right? Because of that, our positive charge will move a little bit towards this side, and the whole our negative charge comprising of the electron cloud, that electron, the shape of the electron cloud will become distracted, right? Because of that, your whole negative charge will move in the opposite direction. So without the application of electric field, your positive and negative charge centers were coinciding. But once you apply an electric field, what will happen? Then your positive and negative charges are not coinciding, and they are displaced. Understood? The charge centers are displaced. Here you can, I put the electrons or the negative signs more towards the right side than the left side. Means your charges are displaced a bit. So now your negative charge sender will appear somewhere here, right? So there is a displacement between positive and negative charge. Okay. Or we can represent it like this way. So this is the third figure here. This is the figure which corresponds to our situation. That is quite equivalent to considering that this is our normal atom. Normal atom plus what? Plus a dipole moment, right? That is what happened. Now, when we were not having an electric field, then there was no dipole moment because our positive and negative charges were just coinciding at the same place. But now, once we apply an electric field, what happens? Then it created a dipole because there is charge displacement. It is equivalent to placing plus Q and minus Q at a distance d. I am considering this distance as d, whatever be the displacement. So under this condition, under the application of electric field, we created a dipole, right? Before the atom was neutral, but now in an insulator or dielectric, we created a dipole when we apply an electric field. Clear? Now let us define dipole moment. As we already discussed, we have minus q and plus q displaced by the electric field with a distance between them as d. So what is dipole moment? This we already defined once before in a derivation for a dipole, right? Electric dipole. What is the electric field produced and all? So there the dipole moment is defined as what? The small letter p, dipole moment is defined as charge into distance between the two charges, right? So that is q into d. And here the direction of d is taken from minus q to plus q. So your dipole moment will be directed from where to where? From minus q to plus q. So that will be the dipole moment vector. So now let us that is one quantity here, that which is the dipole moment we defined, right? So now consider a volume delta v. Now let us consider a volume delta v where we have, now this is one dipole, right? When you are considering a dielectric, you will have a n number of atoms like that, right? So whenever you apply electric field, n number of such dipole moments will be formed. So let us consider a small volume delta v where we have n number of such dipoles. Such dipoles are present. Then what will be the total dipole moment? That total dipole moment we can write as vector p equal to what? Q1 d1 will be the first dipole's moment, then q2 d2 second one, like that, whatever be the number, like qn dn, because here the charge also may vary, right? So when it's a mixture or something, even the charge also may vary, whatever. So q1 d1 plus q2 d2 up to qn dn. So that sum will give you the total dipole moment, or we can write it as a summation, right? Sigma k equal to 1 to n qk dk, when you have n number of such dipoles in your delta v volume. Now let us define another quantity which is called as polarization, the capital vector P. Polarization is defined as dipole moment per unit volume, right? Dipole moment per unit volume. So we already discussed that what is the total dipole moment in an area delta v, that is given by sigma k equal to 1 to n qk dk, right? So divided by delta v, under the limits delta v tends to 0, then it becomes what? Polarization polarization per unit volume. So that is what we do here. Limit delta v tends to zero, sigma k equal to 1 to n qk vk by del v delta v will give you what? The polarization. Polarization is defined as a dipole moment per unit volume. If you check the units here, when you are taking dipole moment, then what is its unit? Its unit is in what? Q into d is the dipole moment. So q means what? Coulomb. And the distance is expressed in watt meter. So coulomb meter is the unit for dipole moment. Whereas if for in polarization, what is the unit? The upper side is again dipole moment only. So it is coulomb per meter. V means what? The volume. So the denominator will become meter cube. So the total unit of polarization will be what? Coulomb per meter square. Right? Coulomb per meter square, that will be the unit of polarization vector. Just remember this, because some other quantities unit also is same, means what? Coulomb per meter square, that we will see afterwards. So that is about polarization. So So under this condition, let us make our observation very clear. So under this condition, we say that our dielectric is polarized. When you apply an electric field, then what a displacement happen between the positive and negative charges. So under that condition, we say that a dipole moment is already present, right? Under this condition, we say that a dipole moment is already present. So that is our observation. And once this dipoles are formed, it will try to align in the direction of electric field also. Clear? So basically, why it is happening? It is happening due to the displacement of the charges present. So that much is our observation about polarization. Polarization in a material happens, or in a dielectric happens, when we apply an electric field. Under the application of electric field, what will happen? Under the application of electric field, we have it is like on the charges we are applying some force. So because of the force, this charges are getting displaced onto both sides. Because of that, we have a dipole moment. Clear? So now let's get into the two types of dipoles. Whatever we were discussing till now, they are called as non-polar dielectrics, because without any electric field applied, there is no dipole moment at all. Your positive charge sender and the negative charge sender are coinciding with each other. Because of that, there is no dipole moment at all, or there is no polarization at all. So such dielectrics are called as non-polar dielectrics. Right? Examples are like hydrogen. Hydrogen is one example, and nitrogen is another example. Oxygen is another example. So if you go back to your higher secondary classes and all, you will know that when you have the same kind of hydrogen means what? Hydrogen molecule means what? Two hydrogen atoms. Nitrogen molecule means two nitrogen atoms. Oxygen molecule means two oxygen atoms. So both of them are similar. Because of that, they're just like in an atom, their positive and negative charge centers will coincide, or there will not be any net dipole moment when we are not applying an electric field. Since we have the same kind of material, same kind of atom in this molecules, we cannot say that one is have the charge sender will have a difference or something. So such materials are examples for non-polar dielectrics. Other than that, we have the noble gases. As we were discussing about an atom, it is quite sure that our all noble gases are also examples of what? The non-polar dielectrics. Because noble gases means they exist as it is, means they don't form, it is monoatomic molecules, or only one atom is there. So under that condition, whatever I discussed about polarization just before applies straight to the helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon family of noble gases. So that is quite clear. So what we are trying to tell here is that these gases do not have any dipoles without the application of electric field. When field is applied, definitely dipoles are created and they are aligned. But without the application of electric field, there is no net dipole moment. Such dielectrics are called as non-polar dielectrics. Now let us get into the polar dielectrics. One very good example for polar dielectric is water. Right? Why water is an example? Because in water, as you can see, there is one oxygen atom here and there are two hydrogen atoms on the sides. They are dissimilar atoms, right? So dissimilar atoms will have what? Dissimilar ionization potential, we say, or electronegativity, we say. So whatever it means is that their interest or their ability to attract or repel an electron will be different. Because of that, they will have a net dipole moment. And when the structure is considered, you can see that there are two OH hands, right? So they are having some direction also. Because of that, you will have a net dipole moment for water molecule. Similar is the condition for sulfur dioxide, where you have two sulfur oxygen double bonds, same, just the angle will change, but it will also have what? The net dipole moment. That will depend on the electronegativity of these two atoms, sulfur as well as oxygen. Then there is another one called hydrochloric acid, or HCl. In HCl, what happens is that, as you can see here, this one part you have hydrogen, other part is Cl. Both of the electronegativity difference will create a small shift in the charge, so that also is an example for polar dielectric. So In all these examples, without the application of electric field itself, they are having a dipole moment. Understood? Because their structure is like that. In non-polar, without the application of electric field, there is no dipole moment at all. So these are that is the difference between polar and non-polar dielectrics. This means these molecules possess a permanent dipole. They possess permanent dipoles in the absence of electric field also. So what will happen in the absence of electric field, one interesting part is that even though they have permanent dipole moment, but all over it will be randomly oriented, so that again there will not be a net dipole moment for the material. They will be randomly oriented inside the material, so that net dipole moment will be zero. And even under the when we are not applying an electric field, what will happen when we apply an electric field? Without the application of electric field, our dipoles will be quite like this, means oriented in some random direction. When we apply electric field, this two charges or these dipoles on them, their torque will be applied and they will align in the direction of electric field, or they are getting oriented in the direction of electric field. That is what happens in polar dielectrics. Okay. So this is when we apply an electric field. This is frankly, this is when you are keeping a positive and a negative plate on this on two sides, right? Like here you are keeping your positive plate and here you are keeping your negative plate. Consider that you are applying AC or alternating current here. Then what will happen? Your positive and negative on two sides will change in every half cycle, right? When you are having an AC supply, what will happen? In an AC supply, your positive and negative charge will change in every half cycle. So, what we do in a microwave oven or kind of things is that we are applying a very high frequency potential, so that there this water molecules they are polar, right? So, because since they are polar molecules, they will try to orient in one direction for one half cycle, another direction for another half cycle, and the friction between them is used for the heating purpose. That is the principle of microwave oven and all. You can see if you are interested. Then let us see what is meant by dielectric constant. For understanding dielectric constant, let us take the example of a two parallel plates which are having a cross section of A, and they are the distance between them is given by D. The area cross section of each of the plate is A, and distance between them is given by D. Right? This is a classic example, or you know this example, right? So let me say, when you apply potential, a charge plus Q0 is there on one side, and there is a minus Q0 charge on the other side. So what is capacitance? This we already defined. Capacitance C0, since our material, we are not placing any material in between, so it is given by epsilon 0 A divided by V, right? Or C in terms of charge, right? Capacitance is what? The ability to store charge. So C can be also be given by what? C can be also be given by Q0 into V. Sorry, this is wrong. C0 is given by what? C is given by charge per potential, or Q0 divided by V. I am sorry about this. Q0 divided by V will give you what? The capacitance of this material. Right? Charge per potential. That also is one definition for capacitance. So, that, and because of that, you will have an electric field setup. We already derived what will be the electric field in, for a parallel plate combination. In our second module, that is, which is given by sigma by epsilon 0, sigma by 2 epsilon 0 when we have only one plate, and when there are two plates, then we had we found that it will be sigma by epsilon 0. So the same thing will be equal to what? V divided by D, or V equal to E into electric potential is what? Potential is electric field is meant by potential per unit length. So V by D, particularly for this geometry where you have two parallel plates, so that also is known to you. Then the electric flux density D is given by what? Epsilon 0 times the electric field density. This much is known to you from your last module. Now the charge, as we have defined capacitance in terms of charge, If we have C0 equal to Q0 into V, Q0 is given by what? C0 times potential. So means this potential will go here. So C0 times potential is Q0. Or that C0, if we substitute epsilon 0 A by D, then this equation will come. What? Epsilon 0 A into V by D. And we already, I already told you that V by D will be equal to the electric field intensity. So we can write Q0 as epsilon 0 times A into E. Right. Now let us insert a dielectric. Now we inserted a dielectric. Once that is what Faraday also did, and that is how he defined the dielectric constant of a material. First he saw what is the capacitance when we are not having any material, or it is free space or air. Then he put a material and saw what is the capacitance. So he divided both those terms, which is C divided by C naught, which is given by the dielectric relative permittivity or dielectric constant of the material. Epsilon R is called as dielectric constant of relative permittivity of the material. This is how Michael Faraday defined the permittivity or the relative permittivity or dielectric constant. Okay, what I want you to remember here is that our charge Q0 means whatever be the charge stored in this capacitor plate is equal to epsilon 0 A times E. So let us see what will happen in a dielectric when we are placing dielectric material, right? So Faraday defined it as dielectric constant as the capacitor factor by which your capacitance is increasing when you are placing a dielectric material. So epsilon R is a positive quantity, or it will be always greater than zero. Permittivity is expressed in farads per meter, but relative permittivity is always expressed in it is unitless or it is dimensionless. So epsilon R is the factor. So what happens really when we are placing our dielectric slab? Polarization will happen. All the dipoles will start aligning in the direction of this electric field caused by the potential V applied. So because of that, we will have a charge, negative charge placed nearby the positive placed inside the material, and we will have a positive charge on the other side, right? Positive charge nearby the negative plate on the other side. So like this, we will have a layer of charges nearby the surface. The difference is that these charges on the surface are bounded charges, means they cannot move. They just got displaced. That is what it means. So we have a layer on both the sides. One on the other side, and another one on this side. So the last slide we discussed about Q0, the charge whenever we are not having any dielectric, that is equal to what? Epsilon 0 A times E, right? Epsilon 0 A times E. When we place a dielectric material, then your permittivity has become what? It will be equal to epsilon 0 epsilon R. So the new charge Q1, whenever we are having a dielectric of permittivity epsilon R, will be what? Epsilon 0 epsilon R times A into E. Just you are getting the term is getting multiplied, right? That is what is meant by dielectric constant or relative permittivity. So what effectively happened is that without the dielectric material in between, we were having Q0, and with the dielectric place, your charge is getting multiplied by a factor epsilon R. So your charge is increased compared the charge which the capacitance can store, that has increased compared to without the dielectric place. So what is the increase in charge? That is given by Q1 minus Q0. That will, this increase in charge will definitely depend on what? That will depend on the relative permittivity. That will be equal to epsilon 0 epsilon R A E, which is Q1, right? Q1 is epsilon 0 epsilon R A E. And what is Q0? Means without a dielectric, it will be equal to epsilon 0 A E. We can take epsilon 0 A E as common in this equation. So our increase in charge Q1 minus Q0 will be equal to epsilon 0 A E into epsilon R minus 1. Clear about this equation? That defines the increase in charge. Okay, that increase in charge is what we are saying about this two layers. This Q1 minus Q0 only is coming as this two layers on the two sides. Okay, understood? Because it will depend on how much your dielectric material is polarized. So the dipole moment will be correspond to this increase in charge storage. So we can write the dipole moment P is equal to Q1 minus Q0 into D. Means whatever be the net charge which is getting displaced into the displacement between the two charges. So that is, which is the distance between the two plates, Q1 minus Q0 into D. This Q1 minus Q0 we already derived as epsilon 0 A into epsilon r minus 1 into D will give you dipole moment. That is about dipole moment. We already defined polarization. Polarization is dipole moment per volume, right? Dipole moment per unit volume. When we have dipole moment, which is given by epsilon 0 A E into epsilon r minus 1 into D, then you, what is the volume? Volume in the capacitor is area into the distance between the two plates. That is the volume occupied by the dielectric, right? Area of cross section into the distance between the plates. That will give you the volume occupied by the dielectric. So the net polarization is given by this quantity. You can cut down AD on the numerator and the denominator so that you will get polarization as epsilon 0 epsilon into epsilon r minus 1 into E. That is the equation for polarization inside a dielectric, right? When you are considering this parallel plate case, this same equation I can just rewrite here, taking off the brackets as this epsilon 0 epsilon r E minus epsilon 0 times E, right? There is a reason why I am writing this. So as I said, the charge has increased. Similarly, your electric flux density also should increase. Electric flux density, when you are placing a dielectric material, is epsilon 0 epsilon r times E, right? D equal to what? Epsilon E, that we already discussed in the second module. So the electric flux density is equal to epsilon times the electric field density, where your epsilon is here it is epsilon 0 epsilon r, right? So that is electric flux density. If we apply this equation, substitute this equation in the first equation for polarization, what we are going to get is this. P is given by D minus epsilon 0 E, or we can rewrite it as electric flux density is equal to epsilon 0 E. What is epsilon 0 E? Epsilon 0 E is the electric flux density when we are not placing any dielectric. Epsilon 0 E is the electric flux density when we are not placing any dielectric. With that, our electric flux density has increased by what? By the amount of polarization P. That is why I discussed polarization's unit in particular before. What is the unit of polarization? Unit of polarization is coulomb per meter square. We have discussed it in before 2-3 slides, right? So the same is the unit of what? Dielectric flux density also. Electric flux unit is coulomb, right? Electric flux is, unit is coulomb. And electric flux density means what? Coulombs per area, means coulomb per meter square. That is the electric flux density, which is equal to what? Which is equal to what? Polarization plus epsilon 0 times E, where epsilon 0 E times again is the electric flux density when we are not putting any dielectric in between. So polarization is what polarization does is that polarization is increasing the electric flux density inside a material. That is why we say we are able to store more charge. So now, in most of the material, this polarization may be proportional to the applied field, right? That is what we written as P equal to epsilon 0 into epsilon r minus 1 into E, right? So this epsilon r minus 1, we replace it with the chi, or we call it as susceptibility, dielectric susceptibility, or chi is equal to epsilon r minus 1. So that is another quantity which represents the proportionality of polarization happening with the electric field intensity. How much proportional our electric field density is with the polarization. So that is another quantity of our interest. So that is about the different terms regarding dielectrics and polarization. We discussed about the dipole moment, which is what charge into the displacement between the two charges. Then about polarization, which is dipole moment per unit volume. Then we discussed about permittivity and relative permittivity of the dielectric constant as well. Now, as I said, normally dielectric is an insulator and it will not allow the conduction of current. So inside dielectric, we usually call charges bounded charges. Outside, we call that it is free charges. So, but this is not true always. When we start applying electric field, and whenever it exceeds above a particular value, then our dielectric will start conducting. An example is air, an example of a dielectric is air, right? Air is a dielectric, and lightning is an example of the dielectric breakdown happening in air. When your clouds are having so much charge and the electric field density exceeds whatever be the breakdown strength of air, then that is when your lightning will occur. Similarly, the second figure here is about the breakdown for an oil. So when we apply potential between these two electrodes here, after some particular level of potential, or after whenever you say your potential is increasing, then electric field is V by D. So whenever V increases, electric field intensity also will increase. So whenever it reaches above some particular value, your dielectric will break down. That is about dielectric breakdown. So we can define our dielectric strength as the maximum electric field a dielectric can withstand without electrical breakdown. The maximum dielectric strength an electric field the maximum electric field a dielectric can withstand without electric breakdown is what is called as dielectric strength of a material. It is expressed in volts per meter, or in terms of electric field intensity. One more portion in dielectric is the types of dielectrics. Okay, so there are two types of dielectrics in terms of its linearity. We call linear and nonlinear dielectric. Linear means what? When we say D is varying linearly with E, then it is a linear dielectric. When D is not varying linearly with E, then we call as nonlinear dielectric. That is what is meant by linear and nonlinear dielectrics. Okay. Then another type of dielectric is homogeneous dielectric. Homogeneous dielectric means the material, when we consider region, inside that your epsilon or the permittivity of the material is not varying. It is constant everywhere inside a particular material. When you are considering a mixture, or let us consider air, right? Air is a mixture, or even air, its temperature, the humidity level, these all things will vary with the height in the atmosphere. So because of that, with that, your permittivity also will vary in will be different at different places in the atmosphere. So that is an example of inhomogeneous dielectric. In homogeneous dielectric, we will have the same permittivity all the places in the material. Just like if you take pure water, inside every point, pure water will have the same permittivity. But it will be different in case of air, because air, in air, humidity, temperature, the different parameters will decide what is the permittivity at a particular point. Then there is isotropic dielectrics. In isotropic dielectrics, permittivity will be same in all directions. Means it is not directional quantity. Permittivity is not a directional quantity. And in anisotropic dielectrics, this dielectric permittivity will change with the direction. So that is the difference between isotropic and anisotropic dielectrics. Okay. So in this lecture, till now we were covering about polarization. So let us just discuss again. Dielectric polarization means what? In dielectric polarization, when you are having a non-polar dielectric, under the application of electric field, your charges are getting displaced. Your charges are getting displaced a bit, so that there is a net dipole moment coming, and because of that, polarization is happening. And when you apply an electric field, since your dipoles are created, due to that, you have a net polarization in the material, or you say your dielectric is polarized. And when you have a polar molecule, it is already having dipole moment, even though your electric field is not applied. But they are randomly placed when your electric field is not applied, and they all will try to align in the direction of electric field when you are applying an electric field. So that is about polarization, and we discussed different quantities like dipole moment, polarization, and dielectric constant of the material. So that was our discussion mainly. And afterwards, we also discuss what is meant by what is meant by the dielectric strength of the material, which depends on the dielectric breakdown of the material. Afterwards, some other terms regarding the types of dielectrics, like linear, isotropic, anisotropic, and homogeneous, inhomogeneous dielectrics, were also discussed. With this, we are completing polarization. Next, we will be on deriving the continuity equation of current. So that we will see in the next class. And now after this lecture, please get into the review questions, answer them. And if you have any doubt regarding the derivation or concepts during this session, you can discuss with me on Google Meet. First WhatsApp me if you have any query. Then accordingly, we will have a Google Meet session. Thank you.